Abu.
Amen.
Abu.
Amen.
Abu.
Amen.
All right, wonderful to have you here this morning. This morning we are enchanted and delighted to have a very exciting presentation dealing with whose history is it, the history of Elmina. And we also have our distinguished chair, head of department from the history department, Professor Akosua Perbi. She was educated at Achimota School, where she was class prefect. In her 31 years of service, she has taught over 6,000 students in various courses in the history of Africa, and she's saying it's much more than that by this time. This must be an old thing. But she is most well known for her award-winning book, The History of Indigenous Slavery in Ghana. So we thought that she would be an excellent choice to chair. She's been here before, both as chair and presenter in back-to-back weeks, so she is definitely a friend of IAS. So we're happy to have her here today, and with no further ado, I'll turn it over to her. Well, with slightly further ado, she said that she wants to make sure that we have an updated picture of her so everyone can see that she is a real
Africa mama.
So we will do that for her next time. But for this time, I'll hand it over to her and she will introduce our speaker for today.
Thank you very much, Madali. Good morning.
Good morning.
My seniors and my colleagues and my peers. When I come to Afghan Studies, I go through memory lane because my father was the first African director, Professor Nketia. And when he came in 1952, I was a 3-month baby. So I spent all my almost 63 years on this campus. And when I enter Afghan Studies, like memory. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Professor Larry Yarak. He is currently a Fulbright scholar with us in the Department of History. And he's done an updated CV for me. I don't know whether if I read it all, it will take about another 20 minutes. But educated Northwestern 1983, has worked as an assistant professor, George Williams College, Illinois, 83-85, and from 1985. He's the associate professor of history, Texas A&M. Publications galore, about 2 pages. But I think the most popular is his book, on Asante and the Dutch, 1744-1873, which was published in 1990. He has many articles, book chapters, and so on. He began his work in Ghana in 1978, and he was one of those who was a founding editor of the Ghana Studies Journal. Professor Yarak, we are happy to listen to you. He's going to talk this morning on history and popular memory in Elmina. Can we give him a round of applause?
Professor, thank you very much for that kind introduction, and thank you all for coming out. I see many friends and colleagues, and old friends and colleagues, and very pleased that you all could make it this morning early. I also quickly want to say thank you to the Fulbright agencies that have made it possible for me to be here for a year, and to the University of Ghana, and to the head of departments of the history department here that have made it possible for me to have an extended stay once again back in Ghana. So the topic that's indicated here is history and popular memory, and the slide is showing you perhaps a not very well-known image of Elmina done by the British in 1806, a British engraving. And what I like about this is it's not entirely accurate, but it does show you the existence of the town of Elmina right next to the castle, so-called castle. Today, those of you who visit Elmina know that there's nothing there. That town was destroyed by the British in 1873 with important consequences, I think, for Elmina history, and I'll be talking about that a little bit later on. So what do we mean by history and memory? Well, there's a whole genre of historical literature about that. I would call them history and memory studies. Since the 1990s, a number of scholars have been focusing on this area. It's captured the interest of historians around the world. The two terms are often used in contrast with one another, and even seen as opposed to one another. In history, the way I would like to present this, my talk today, history as the realm of the academic, what academics do, and memory as the area that the people, however defined, maintain memories about the past, collective, social, popular, these are all terms that have been used by historians to designate this kind of history. And this is done not just in Africa, obviously, but this is done around the world. In fact, many of the beginnings of popular or collective history were done in the studies of the Jewish diaspora and the Holocaust. So there's a tendency among historians to see these two as opposed, and what I want to do today is, in fact, get some of your reaction as well to the idea that it's possible to see these as interacting realms, though they often have distinct purposes. So let me just quickly kind of outline some of what I see are kind of big differences. So academic history, I hate to belabor this point, but just to make it clear what I mean by that, it's an interpretation or a narrative usually constructed by a scholar. It's based on the rigorous and critical study of all available evidence, written, oral, so that means memory as well, material, the archaeologist's work, linguistic, the work done by linguists. The audience is usually, that is, for whom this is produced, is usually other historians, primarily. It's a profession. And it is often also, of course, directed towards students that we teach, since most of us are located in universities, whether in Africa or outside. Popular memory, also again known as public or collective or social memory, on the other hand, is quite distinctive. It's the product, as I suggest here, of social interaction among people who would not be regarded as professionals, though they may be regarded as important figures in their own society. But they're usually doing something else in addition to being a person holding memory of the past. And what they do is they share what they have been told by others. Now, this is very often, as scholars who have done work on oral traditions, this is very often closely linked to questions of identity. Who are we? Subjectivity. What are we doing here? How do we relate to other people? So it's not only connected with memory, remembering the past, but also connected with forgetting, silencing, things that are unpleasant, things that may undermine existing social order. Memory is usually jogged and produced by what we call mnemonics, things that help us remember. They can be things like ritual, poetry, prayer, song, dance. But they're also, one of the interesting areas of study is that which pertains to physical objects. They're connected to museums, they're connected to buildings, they're connected to spaces that people inhabit. And that has important implications for Elmina, it seems to me. So, popular memory in Elmina, an example, of course, are oral traditions, of which there's a great variety, and often multiple versions of different stories told about the past. Some of them are held secret from others, and they are, for the historian trying to understand Elmina's past, somewhat difficult to try to extract, since they're, by their very nature, they are not meant to be shared. Some of the most vital memories that I've come across in Elmina are family histories. Relations between individuals and their ancestors. Now, the secret traditions, again, I think have a very important role to play, and it's important to realize that this is one of the things that dogs, the scholar, trying to reconstruct the past of any society, including African societies. And I give you the quote here from D.T. Nyane's famous translation of the tale of Sundiata. By the griot in Mali, And I take this quote from him, with them, that is the people who have written history, everybody thinks he knows, whereas learning should be a secret. And I think that's something to keep in mind when we try to make assessments of, and there has to be a certain amount of caution, obviously, in dealing, as I've tried to be cautious with my own work. Folk etymology is another source of popular memory, and I could give you some examples of this, of how shifting explanations of the names of particular places in Elmina have changed over time. As I've said, the idea of physical mnemonics, it's important to realize that Elmina's town was destroyed by the British in 1873, and the people of Elmina were not allowed to rebuild on that spot. So those particular places that had been occupied by people for hundreds of years were now removed from their ability to make connections with. And I think that has had a profound impact on, and in a sense, has kind of broken loose an important mooring for Elmina history. Something that's called sites of memory by scholars. So how do we assess written sources? And this is, again, something that I've been engaged in as well. These are the kinds of things, and I hate to belabor this for those of you who are practicing historians, this will be just standard stuff. But to make sure that you understand where I'm coming from, we think about things like provenance, origins of these documents, whether they're published or archival. That is, who are they intended to influence? A general broad audience, a series of superiors in a bureaucratic institution, and so forth. What kind of genre, particularly for written materials, what kind of genre does this represent? Literary sources. And of course, foreigners, people from outside of Africa, particularly British, the Dutch, the Danes, so forth, brought with them all kinds of preconceptions, notions about themselves, nationalism, their existence, and their competition with one another. They often were quite jealous of one another, British, Dutch, and Danes. They were often ethnocentric, believing that their particular brand of culture was superior. And by the 19th century, we get the development of a strong sense of racist ideology that pervades many of the sources. So historians of Africa have over the years, no matter where you're from, to read these documents, the European sources, the archival sources, what we call against the grain. The grain's leading in one direction, but we look for it. We look for the voices, the information about the past from what one famous scholar, who in fact is going to be giving the Agri-Fraser of Gugisberg lectures, Beatrice Bivak, is famous for her work on the subaltern, the subordinate, the oppressed. Oral traditions, on the other hand, require a different set of skills and ideas about how we assess them. The major figure for historians who's done most work on critically assessing oral traditions is Jan van Sina, a book published in 1985. And he noted that these group accounts, what he calls group accounts, oral traditions exist in multiple versions, and they exist in multiple versions within a particular society, and then neighboring societies will often have memories that will exist in multiple versions about their relations with them, and even about the own history of the people next to them. They conflict, and so we also have to try to reconcile these conflicts between oral traditions. There's a tendency on the part of many to think of oral traditions as simply a body of literature. In fact, there are many different versions of any particular important, as I'll show in just a bit, any distinct and important tradition that plays a key role in society. As I've said, also there's a tendency among oral traditions to silence what could be called inconvenient events, embarrassment, loss, or to elide them to, or simply to explain them away. They change over time, and what you see in some oral traditions, particularly those that pertain to origin, that reach way back in memory, they tend to be stereotypical, and they tend to operate in terms of cliches. I'll give you an example of that later on. And finally, David Hennig, who worked here in Ghana, in fact worked in Elmina, many years ago, now retired librarian at the University of Wisconsin. He was famous for developing the idea of feedback. That is, as societies, particularly in Ghana, with this early embrace of Western-style education by people of the coast principally, there were the development of literary traditions, writing, and so forth, and the appropriation of ideas from European documents that had already been published, and then they get entered into, they, people of some authority in the society, their ideas, their appropriation of material from written sources gets introduced into oral tradition. Let me talk a little bit about the sources I've used. Again, there's Elmina has got one of the wealthiest documentary bases of any society in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, for certain. Their archival materials in Portugal, though many of them were lost. There's really, tragically, a fire that occurred sometime in the 18th century, I believe, that destroyed a lot of Portuguese documents from Elmina, which we would love to have. The Dutch and the British are much richer, and the Dutch in particular, who lived in Elmina Castle. And not only do they tell about what they saw, how they interacted with people in Elmina, how they interacted with other Europeans on the coast, they also occasionally have bits of oral tradition that they wrote down, things that they thought were relevant to their activities. They would record them in conversation with local people in Elmina. In the archives in Accra, there's the records of the Secretary of Native Affairs. And there is, like many coastal societies in Ghana in the colonial period, there were many, many disputes about school succession. And as a result, a number of inquiries were held into school affairs, some very, very detailed. And in the case of Elmina, two really good ones in 1912 and 1914, and then a very rich one in 1934, a school inquiry with interviews of prominent people in Elmina, knowledgeable oral historians, and it was conducted principally by two chiefs, one from Winneba and one from Afanti town, and it runs over 200 pages in length, so quite a rich source. And then there's even court records. There was an attempt to destool or prevent the succession of a king in 1899 that I also have found quite useful. And of course, there are the early reports about Elmina history in the Gold Coast Press. In particular, the Gold Coast Aborigines was one that had several articles. The Western Echo was another one about Elmina history. So there's a wealth of written sources for Elmina history. And the problem is, in fact, just dealing with this massive information. And then, in addition, we have oral sources. And as I've said, they've been recorded in court cases. They're cited in many works, such as John Mensah-Sarba's work, which I'll talk about in just a minute. Former professor in the history department, John Kofi Finn, has a short piece on oral traditions in Elmina. And I've done my own work since the late 70s, and coming back and asking, and many of my earliest informants have passed away, but I've been able to capture some of their thoughts. So what I want to do in my time here is talk about two case studies, and as I indicate here, show that the oral traditions regarding these two areas, number one, the building of Elmina Castle, the story about Diego de Azambuja, which I think many of you Ghanaians will be familiar with. It's something that's spread out of Elmina and become part of a more general Ghanaian history. And then one that is more limited to the history of Elmina itself. And it's a story that purports to explain the origins of patrilineality in the kingship of Elmina. And what I want to show is that these arose in the 20th century. They were a product of the changes that occurred in life under colonial rule. So this challenges fundamentally the idea that these oral traditions are things that were told and passed down through many, many generations, but in fact they began to be told only in the 20th century. And the stories were held to be something that went, reached further back in the past. So what are we to do when our academic study of history conflicts with or contradicts these believable and strongly held beliefs on the part of the Elmina people themselves? So what's the role of the academic historian? And I want to leave that to you, and that would be a thing. So let me just talk a little bit about this. The Elmina King, and I put in quotation marks, Pamana Ansa. What do we know about this Pamana Ansa in written sources? Now, actually, my own work only supplements work that's already been done by David Henning and by an Afro-American historian, Bio Holsley, published an important article just recently in 2011 about who was Pamana Ansa, where did this story come from. And what they found is that the 1482 encounter that it purports to discuss between Diego da Zambuja, the Portuguese leader of the expedition that was sent to build the castle in January of 1482, had an interaction with somebody that the Portuguese called Caramansa. Today, that is taken as simply a corruption of Comana Ansa. Where did that come from? Where did the story come from? Well, actually, what Bio Hosley particularly had found out is that if you go back to one of the early, but not eyewitness accounts of the building of the castle, 1552, decades after the building of the castle, decades after the arrival of the Portuguese, he described what he purported to be a conversation between Diego da Zambuja and Pamana Ansa. This remains sort of unknown. It was done in Portuguese, published in 1552. But in the 17th century, it was translated into English. And an Englishman by the name of James Clark in 1805 got a hold of that translation, and he embellished the account. He obviously reported it in English. And he made Pamana Ansa a king, something that the original source, Barros, does not mention. Does not say that Caramansa was a king. He just says he was the leader of this area that happened to be there. And it doesn't say that he was a king or a leader of Elmina. He's just given as a leader, somebody who had the authority to grant the Portuguese permission to build their castle. John Nassasarba in 1906, in a book that repeated this, quoted Clark, and he used this story that Clark told, and to interpret and to make the case for African agency, the agency of Pamana Ansa, the achievement of a state, a kingship already in existence in Elmina, way back in the 15th century. And so what Hosley says, and I think she's quite persuasive, is that this story developed as in an effort to begin the process of constructing a form of Gold Coast and Ghana nationalism that we come later on. W.W. Claridge, in another influential and widely read book in 1915, followed Sarba. Again, just these people are kind of just taking the words of others, often without attribution, which was the common occurrence way back in the 19th and early 20th century. And then in 1929, a really important book was published by a member of the coastal elite, E.J.P. Brown, the Gold Coast and Asante Reader, a book that was widely used to teach people to read and stories about the past. And he turned this, he slightly twisted this, what Sarba had cited, into a critique of colonialism. His idea had already developed to the point that he was trying to show that what he emphasized in the story was the perfidy, the double dealing of the Portuguese. And so he turned it into that. In 1950, an Elmina writer, the name of Sylvanus Wartenberg, he elaborated on this story, again in his book. And he placed Pamana Ansa on an expanded list of Elmina kings, after a man who he said was the founder of Elmina, Kwa Among Kwa, as you call him. Today, if you go into Elmina, as I did way back in 1978, as many other scholars, the first thing people, when you say, I'm coming in to find out about the history of your town, the first thing they say is, well, it's all here in Wartenberg's book. So this is all you really need to know. It's hard to push beyond any of that. His king list is seen as authoritative, so much so that, and you can see the king list in Finn's book, and it is Wartenberg's list of kings that you see in Elmina Castle today. If you go in and you go into the old Portuguese church, where there is now an exhibition of photographs, that you will see that. So what you have here is clearly a case of feedback. And one of the things that, again, kind of surprised me a bit when I went in and looked at that and took a picture of the king's list, which then I saw was completely straight out of Wartenberg. Wartenberg got the dates of the return of Covenant John wrong in his book, and they repeated it in the castle. And yet if you walk down the street, you go to the cemetery, there's a headstone there for Covenant John that gives different dates, and in fact gives the correct dates according to what we see in the archives. So he's more important than what people even can see in the cemetery. It's interesting. Now, what Hennig did in 1974 was give a list, and I won't belabor it, but you can see Wartenberg's very complete on the left. So all of those names, going back to what he says, qua mon qua, was in 1300, in the 14th century, long before the Portuguese arrived. 1889, if you look at that one, the court case, and he didn't quite get this entirely correct, but I went back and looked at the court case carefully, and so there's some little things that he didn't get right here. But essentially, all they have is qua mon qua, or the founder is also known as Edina in 1899, something I'll come back to. And then one or two others, and then in the 19th century, Kobana Ahin. This Kobana Ahin, Ebu, Anawi, Diawu, Konwa, these are actually absolutely accurate according to the records that we find. So into the beginning of the 19th century, everything is quite nice. You push back before 1800, and things really get kind of wonky. In 1934, two different members of the Elmina elite gave testimony about the kingship, and they mentioned J.J.C. Smith doesn't mention Qua Mon Qua at all. Instead, he has a different list. One of the senior chiefs of Elmina, who, by the way, ultimately would be executed for murder, I'll come to that a little later on, but in 1934, he was a very senior member of the Elmina elite, Nana Apramesong. He gave this list, which was obviously much longer and more in tune with what Wartenberg would come up with later on. So, what did they conclude? And I find this to be persuasive. Kamana Ansa is an example. The story of Kamana Ansa is an example of an invented tradition. That is, was something that was meant to serve the purposes of the 20th century. And so it was a story that was required and used for purposes other than simply the history of Elmina, or it was a response to colonial rule. Now, again, I've had my own research. There's things that both Hennig and Holsley missed. They believe, for example, that Karamansa somehow, that story only entered into the consciousness of Elmina in the 20th century. In fact, there is a Dutchman who was in Elmina Castle in the early 19th century, who said that, in fact, there was an engraving on the wall, which no longer I've been unable to find in Elmina today, but he said there was a plaque on the wall of the castle that says, Diego da Zambuja began building this on the 3rd of January, 1482, with the approval of a man called Karamanda, which is the way that Demare wrote it. That may be a typo. In any case, that was available in Elmina, and probably available since 1482. So that information probably circulated, at least among some. Secondly, the oral tradition, again, which neither of them saw, recorded by a Euro-African, who was the translator in Dutch service, in the mid-19th century. He was asked to write a history, a little bit about the customs and the practices and the history of Elmina, and he wrote down that, according to the people that he spoke to, there were two founders of Elmina. One was named Odina, and the other one, Akramanka. So this was already in 1849 or 1850 that this was being written about long before, again, it would come into the 20th century as Caramanza, or Caramanza rather. Acramanca seems to be a kind of early effort to make sense of Caramanda, is what I would argue. In 1886, there was an article in the Western Echo, and it said that the founder was not Acramanca or Cuamanqua, but instead Edna. In 1898, the Gold Coast Aborigines, there was again an article, both of these articles, by the way, are by anonymous members of people from coastal areas. We don't know who they are. And the Gold Coast Press of the 19th century was full of articles written anonymously. In any case, they purport to say the traditional history of Elmina. They said that Elmina was founded by Cuamanqua, this is how it was written, and he met the Portuguese in the 15th century, which today people will say, no, he didn't. He was there long before the Portuguese, and it was Pomananza who met the Portuguese. So again, my concluding analysis, the identity of who this Caramanza is that's mentioned early on may or may not be a real person. And if it was a real person, we'll probably never know who this was and who this actually refers to. I think we've exhausted our sources on that. The alleged exchange between Juan Anza and Diego de Zambuja represents an invented tradition that has today become given the status of an oral tradition. In the 19th century, I think that the idea of Caramanza or Caramanda merged with traditions of the founding of Elmina and became Cuamanqua. And finally, neither Cuamanqua nor Cuamananza are found in any sources before 1850. So one could, I think, ask the question, did they actually ever exist? Okay, that's the one case. The second case is the origins of royal patrilineage. And it's a story that is told in Elmina that probably many of you are not familiar with. It's about a former king, and as I remember it, Ampom Ziadur. And the story about him is meant to explain why it is that in Elmina, kingship passes from father to son, to grandson, and so forth, and does not reside in the family, which in Elmina is, family is still regarded as among most of the Akan as matrilineal. In addition, there is in Elmina a tradition the kingmakers are not the family of the king, but rather the a certain Asafo Company number 7, held in Yampafo. They are held to be, they have that right by virtue of being the descendants of the founder of Cuamanqua. Now this practice of the kingship is rather anomalous among the Akan. We don't find this among very many at all. So the oral tradition is meant to explain how this happened. It tells the story of Ampong Ziador. I could read you, but I think I'm going to... Okay, I don't want to take too much more time. Essentially, what this tradition says is that the kingship passed through nephews, from uncle to nephew, prior to Ampong Ziador's coming to office. This is the way it was since Cuamanqua. Cuamanqua, though interestingly enough, the opponents of this idea in Elmina say, well, why didn't he come with his sister? There's no tradition about him arriving with a sister. Which is also a nice hint. And this is the way that contradicting oral traditions try to make sense of one side or the other. King Ampong was king. He was accused of hiding and stealing funds, a very common assertion of those that want to get rid of a king. And he was said that if he could not produce the proper accounting of all of the school funds, he would be assassinated. He, in this time of need, his sons were the only ones to support him. His nephews, anxious to be king themselves, were opposed to him. They arrested the king. He said, I will show you where all the money is. I will show you. But if I am right and you are wrong, if I can prove that I am not corrupt, then I want you to accept that my sons will succeed me and not my nephews. They will be disenfranchised. So the story, that's the story told. He, of course, produced all of the money. The accounts were clear. And the people had to accept what the king had said. Sons would now end. This is the story that is told. The earliest mention of this Ampong story that I found is in 1899 in a court case that involved an effort on the part of Efuasanka and her sisters. They were the children of a previous king in the 19th century, about whom we know a lot, Nanadziu. They're the daughter, and they were contesting that this man who had just been elected as king, Kwesi Mensa, was ineligible for the stool. He was not senior enough, and he was from the wrong family. And they used the Ampong story not to talk at all about matrilineal, patrilineal. They used it as a way of saying that Kwesi Mensa, who was from the Ekona clan, was not eligible because Ampong Ziador's had three sons that supported him, two of them that supported him and one who didn't. He had a son by an Anona wife who supported him. He had a son by an Nsona wife who supported him. But his son by his Ebiradzi wife did not. So he was should be banned just like the nephews. And Kwesi Mensa, it was agreed by everybody, was neither Nsona or Anona, but was a Kona. And so as a result, the court didn't believe this at all. In the end, they rejected this and said, why are you bringing this case? You have no merit to this story at all. And Kwesi Mensa was allowed to rule. And he ruled from 1899 until 1914. When the faction that did not like him got rid of him and he was destooled. And then after his destoolment, there was a conflict over who would succeed. And then the story of Ampong changed. It was now used in a way to support. The emphasis now was laid upon, which had never been given before in the earlier stories that I found about it, was an emphasis on matrilineality being existing before Ampong Ziador. And the faction that wanted to put forward a new kind of system of descent said, what Ampong did was wrong. And the result is why we have all of these school these destoolments, why our kingship is unstable. What we need to do is return to the system of nephews succeeding, which used to exist in Elmina, but has now stopped. And we will be much better off. In 1915, they could not get the support of the government. They looked back on the 1899 decision and rejected it. But much of that was forgotten. And by 1944, the faction that supported ending succession through males and advocating the change to a matrilineal system, they managed to get the colonial government to gazette this as a fundamental change. This produced a rebellion in Elmina in the middle of World War II. The faction that supported the change back, quote unquote, to matrilineal, were very fearful of losing their court case, and they, in an effort to try to use spiritual means to vindicate themselves, dismembered a young girl in Elmina, a story that many, many people remember in Elmina. And this is the Amakakrava case, a young girl, 10 years old. And she was killed. And as a result, the men, they did a very poor job of hiding the fact that they were responsible for it. Very quickly, they were found out. By the way, the man that they put forward as the new king, matrilineal descent from Ampong Ziador, was Kojo Botsio's father, J.E.K. Botsio. He was not found guilty. He was simply their candidate. Nana Apram Eson, the one I mentioned in 1934, he was the leader of this, along with another chief of a town in the interior of Elmina. These individuals were executed by the British in 1946. And as a result of this case, gazetted in the colonial papers was the fact that kingship in Elmina now goes back to being patrilineal. So the key point here is the story of Amhong's change today, nevertheless, still survives. This is a story that I've been told, and in a paper I gave in the history department just recently, it was reiterated to me by a man from Elmina who was not very happy with what I had to say about this. For me, I've been scouring the archives looking for anybody named Ampong or Ziador, and of course I haven't found them. This is a table of the kings of Elmina, known from the Dutch records. They only go back to the 1730s, so again, not my finding, but the finding of the historian Harvey Feinberg, who's written the book about Elmina in the 18th century. He argues that, in fact, kingship in Elmina was only arose in the 18th century. It does not go back to Kwamonkwa. It does not go back to Kwana Ansa. What you see here are names, particularly Anoe, or Anoe, Ahin, Kweja. These repeat from the 18th into the 19th century. So the suggestion that I would, with this repetition of names, and again, oral traditions that were recorded earlier by the Dutch. All kings were probably patrilineal. There's no evidence of any matrilineality having existed in Elmina before the colonial efforts, the efforts under colonial rule to do that. Now, I will allow that it is possible that Ampong's name was not recorded. If you look back here in number 10 here, question mark, unnamed ruler died in 1794. Now actually, that is, if you look at the way that, where they place Ampong Ziador in the list of kings, that's not bad. That could be the area there. So there's a possibility that there was somebody by that name, but I tend to doubt it. In any case, the Dutch sources on this are unclear and not complete. The Dutch investigation of the school dispute in 1831. Again, these are things that others have not really looked at carefully, other historians. There's no mention of Ampong. There's no mention of any previous. The king at that time, who was being destooled and who defended himself, he talked about who his father was, that his father was a possible king, and decided that he didn't want any part of it because kingship was so troublesome in Elmina. He dashed it to his brother. His brother dashed it to somebody else. And that name that Anoui mentions in 1831 appears. It's a Kweja that appears in the 18th century. And what's interesting, too, is Anoui confessed that on his mother's side, he was of slave origin. Which means not Anona, not Unsona, by any stretch of the imagination. So, and in fact, he's one of two other Elmina kings who in the Dutch sources say specifically on their mother's side, they're of unfree origin, of slave origin. So, in 1850, again, going back to the Euro-African who wrote down Elmina historical traditions, he said, simply, kings are always the sons or grandsons of previous kings. Nevertheless, the Ampong story is vibrant, closely believed by many in Elmina. It's cited in E.J.P. Brown's book in 1929. But it's right next to a very similar story that purports to explain the opposite. A man who's accused of corruption, who had normally and previously always had his succession be in the male line, was supported not by his sons, but by his nephews. And so, chiefship in among the Fanti, it's specifically a Fanti story, chiefship among the Fanti should pass on the nephew side, on the matrilineal side, and not the patrilineal. So I think that this kind of existence of these two stories that appear simultaneously, in fact, E.J.P. Brown has them one right after the other, suggests that we're dealing with here is a kind of cliche or a stereotype. That this is a kind of story that could easily be appropriated to justify a particular kind of action or a policy or a practice in whatever society you're in. So, my conclusion here, analysis of all the available evidence, all Elmina political positions, senior ones, principal ones, the king, the is a group of advisors to the king called the Amamfo, the heads of the Safo. Nobody doubts that the Amamfo and the Asafo heads are all past patrilineally, and always have been. And that's almost certainly the same for the kingship. Amhung stories, again, another example of an invented tradition. It arose in the context, again, of intensified competition for office, set off by British colonial rule, in particular the effort to impose what they called indirect rule. It was advocated, the Amhung story, particularly patrilineal, was part of an effort to curtail the involvement of the Yampapo in the kingship, and to then ultimately to reap what they call reintroduce matrilineality. And this was attempted in 1915. In 1944, it was attempted again, and again with disastrous results, not only child murder, but then the execution of very prominent citizens of Elmina. So, my conclusion, and I'm doing okay, historical investigation leads to questioning the veracity of two important oral traditions. What we find, when we look carefully at all of the oral evidence that's available, we see conflicting narratives, not a single strand. We see also evidence of stereotyping and the use of Vancina calls a historical cliché. But, and this is the key thing, popular memory continues to play a central role in Elmina today. Both of these memories, they buttress, they give identity, they buttress the social order, they give identity. And so they are resistant to the acceptance of this kind of analytical academic exercise. So my question to you is, what are we to do with this? Do we accept a one version or the other, or do they operate in separate realms? One final point. The maintenance of this Ampong Ziadur story and its use for those purposes led to a serious tragedy. If somebody had been doing very careful study in that period of the available sources, which nobody was looking at, certainly not to the length that I and others have done, maybe they wouldn't have succeeded. And Ama Kakraba would still be alive today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Yarak. It's amazing what archival records do, and such a wealth of information. So we'll take contributions, suggestions, commendations from the floor.
Thank you, Larry, for your presentation. You actually bring out some of the things that we continue to struggle with as historians when we go to the records, when we speak to people. So, thanks for bringing this up. I am reminded of L.B. Hartley, who wrote the novel, The Go Between, 1983. His opening words were, "The past is a foreign country. They do things differently there." And in, also in 1999, actually, David Lowenthal wrote a book with the same title, The Past is a Foreign Country. And he actually brings some of these things out. I mean, how much of the past do we take? How much do we change? How much do we just disregard? I think that these are very powerful thoughts that we need to be thinking about. I mean, I'm not from Elmina, so I can't really speak to the oral history of Elmina, but I'm sure that those Elmina would be the better people too.
Make a comment, but also thank you very much for the first part of your work. And actually, it's a comment to you, but also to our students here. The way you did your analysis of the primary sources and the secondary sources, which I think it's very brilliant for our students if they were paying attention. Your methodology and the way you approached the archival sources and the way variations of some narratives. And I must say that even among the living at that time, if you go to the SCT records, there are different versions. And that is why there's a contestation, that's why they go to court. So the way you approach it, I think, is very good for our students to learn, particularly those in the humanities, history, and so on, about how to critique and how to analyze primary sources. And I'm very happy to be recorded. That one day, you know, we'll have to come back to this, your lecture, your seminar, and to look at how Prof. Yarak did his analysis and his critique of the sources. You see, I think that, and it also points on one thing, that it's not everything that is in black and white that is the truth. And that's one thing that we all ought to learn. And that's how come we have to go back and back and back and check, you know. So then that makes our work scholarly. So thank you very much.
Very exciting, engaging presentation, as I thought it would be. I had a few things. I was looking recently at king lists for ancient Kemet, ancient Egypt, and one thing that struck me was that there were about seven different names for every king, their birth name, the royal name, the stool name, etc. From the Dutch king list, I see a lot of question marks and then that one big question mark, which is just a blank space. And I was wondering if you would consider the possibility of any variation of name, perhaps a birth name as opposed to a school name, amongst many other names that would be possible. On the other point, in terms of what Dr. Omwalabi brought up, of not everything in black and white being necessarily the truth, and I think that that's highlighted for the more recent ones in the 1800s, early 1900s of reinventing traditions. And I was also considering that for even some of the more some of the older archival sources for the Dutch. I grew up in North Carolina, and in our history books, we were reading about how Christopher Columbus discovered America, how whenever the Indians attacked, they were savages, blah, blah, blah. This was in black and white as history once I got older. But even at this older stage, I was wondering the degree to which all of these, you mentioned nationalism, racism, etc., may have influenced these things that we may take to be more authoritative because they're older or archival, but may also have those other types of influences.
Well, thank you for those comments, and thank you for the Professor Lavi's comments. I appreciate that very much. I think that's an excellent question Dr. Kambon is posing here, and that is something that I've thought about, and it is something that is very difficult to ascertain whether there would be those problems. These often were done, these names came up because the way that the Dutch saw their relationship with the Elmina authorities was what they called a contract. And so they would occasionally, in fact it was supposed to happen every time there was a new governor that came down from Holland, they were supposed to have a new contract and it would be signed with an X by all of the leaders of Elmina, the heads of the Sapo companies, the king, the under king, or the heir apparent, as they, it was called. And so they would write their names down, and then they would put an X by it. So these were clearly the names. This is the kind of thing that I don't think you can say is influenced by some sort of overarching ideology. They're just simply saying, this is a document, and who are you? And write the name down. So that's where most of these names come from. Occasionally they also mention them. The king came into the castle today, and we spoke about this. His name is this. Another one is the death of a king. When a king died in Elmina in the late 18th and early 19th century, there was a big funeral, and the Dutch would fire 9 to 12 cannon to, again, honor the death of the king. They would give gifts to all of the elders of Elmina on the death of the king. So these things were recorded at that time, but there still is that lingering possibility of different names, of birth names, as you point out, or of private names as opposed to school names. But if you, the ones here are Kobana John, Kobana Konwa, Diowu, Kwamana Anowe, Kobana Ahen, Anowe, Kweja Kuma. These are remembered in Elmina today exactly like that, and these are exactly the names of the Dutch sources. It's when we go beyond this point. So there's a kind of, I mean, I didn't talk about this, but I think in the book I'm writing about this, I'm going to make the case that there were two really big problems. One is that there was a leader who was of the royal line who was killed by the Fanti in 1811. And that was still remembered in the 20th century by his descendants. And he is, in fact, said to be the father and the grandfather of all of these guys, Kobana Ahen Ahen. And this was at a time when Asante and Fanti wars were going on, and Elmina was seen to be an ally of Asante, going on too long about this. Anyway, the point is that I think I can associate this change with some kind of rupture that occurred in Elmina's history that is, has been effectively silenced, that people don't want to talk about. In the 19th century, there was an oath that the Dutch wrote about, an oath that is today forgotten in Elmina, but it referred to that event. So it was enough to produce an oath, a state oath, then in 1868, the Fanti invaded Elmina again for the last time, it was a serious, serious war. And today, that's the key oath in Elmina, Tuesday, the day that they invaded Elmina. So there's a lot of things that go into this, but I take your point, which is quite valid. And so everything that we have to be cautious about.
Also, the word Akin, which comes up so many times, can fancy it can just mean
king.
Thank you very much, Larry. Fascinating stuff. There are some historians I listen to, and then I feel like I wish I had been an historian. Not all historians, but I think you fall into that category. You posed a question to us, and I kind of feel like I want to throw it back to you, because for those of us who are in the social sciences, we rely on the black and white. Many of us don't go into the archives. We hear stories, different stories, and then when we do our own research, we frequently refer to what's written. In my own family, on my father's side, we know the accepted stories, and then when people are sitting together, there are other stories. It's like, don't mind, you know, so-and-so, he doesn't know what he's talking about, she doesn't. Then there are the stories about the other wives and the other mothers, and all of that comes out. But this is the accepted candidate that has been put forward. And as we know, you know, so long as the hunter is telling the story, there's a version. So with these differing stories and the holes to be plugged, and because everybody has an agenda, and it's a political agenda, and it's about their welfare, and their resources, and their sustenance and survival, what are we who cannot all go to the archives and dig up the oral sources and interview people, what are we to do?
I have a recollection of first meeting Larry at the Shangri-La. I have a recollection, I think, meeting Larry for the first time at the Shangri-La Hotel many years ago, early years of the century. I think Tom McCaskey was there. And I was very nervous, as I always am in the presence of historians. He'd read my first novel, Amma, and this was the first time I was meeting him afterwards. And I was a bit relieved. He said, just one error that you had. You had a representative of Asante in Elmina in the late 18th century, and there was no such person. And I wondered where I'd got this false information from, and I went back and I found my source, and I told him by email, and he said, ah, but you haven't read my book closely. I showed that was a false source of information. I want to tell another brief Elmina story, because it relates to what you have said. If you remember, in 2007, there was a celebration of the bicentenary of Wilberforce's law, and the British, the Ghana government handed over to the British Council the responsibility for conducting this celebration. And they called their events reflections. and the reflections were a reflection on the past 200 years. That's from 1807 to 2007 of Ghana-British relations. They chose to ignore the century before this, in which the British were the leading world slave traders. And they made a big deal of this, but there's just one issue, one story that I want to tell. They had a website, and on the website they had a news item. Union Jack flies over Elmina after 134 years. History was made at the Elmina Castle, 25th March 2007, as the Union Jack, which had been banned from the town of Elmina since 1873, was etc., etc. It was hoisted again by, with permission of the Paramount Chief, to announce the reversal of a ban put in place after the British troops bombed Elmina as they tried to quell rioters. Now, this didn't last on the website very long because I think because I pointed out to them that this was a distortion of history and they took it from the website. So if you go back, you wouldn't find it any longer. One last point. I've recently had a historical novel published, set in Elmina, partly in Elmina in the 1860s and 1870s. And okay, I'm not a historian, but doing the research, I had no success in finding any African sources during that period, except as the newspapers were starting soon afterwards. There are about a dozen books by the British participants. And so this raises a question. You have to read between the lines. And it's strange. Somebody, Africanus Horton, for instance, served in the British forces invading Kumasi, but I couldn't find any record from him. And there are other Elmina people, which Michel Dortmund, in that book of Cape Coast personalities, you see that they also served in the forces, in the British forces, on the British side. No records. So it seems to me you historians, you have a big problem there. The story all comes from one side.
Thank you very much, Larry. I enjoyed your presentation. And my conclusion is that we have not done enough on Elmina history at all. So I would wish you will carry on the message that we are doing to come up with something that all of us can agree. On some of the fundamental questions that you raised about the chiefship or kinship, there is some suggestion from oral tradition that Elmina has not really ever had a secular kingship. The chief of Elmina, when he sits in state, sits with white cloth and with a garland of leaves around his neck till this day. The present chief happens to be the younger brother of Dr. Endo, and he's a friend of mine. And I asked him on one occasion, why do you always come into public with this white thing? He said, well, I'm not allowed to put on kente like the other chiefs because I'm a priest king. And this is something that we should take seriously because I'm afraid we have to look at kinship as a much later development, secular kinship, something that came into existence through European contact and perhaps through the introduction of guns. All along the coast, I think there are traditions that suggest that our people were led on their migrations by fetish priests, if you permit the use of that expression. And it was much, much later that these individuals were recognized as secular rulers and so forth and so forth. Now, if you take that as a serious line of investigation, it helps us to understand why Elmina Kish should be a patrilineal. Because in most places where you have the land priests and pastor chiefs and so forth and so on, the patrilineal principle is what is used to elect the priest. And of course, since matrilineal is so strong on the ground, social organization, it's always an interaction. How did you come to rule by matrilineal descent when the whole society is organized? I think the underlying idea is that the leadership of the communities along the coast, the leadership was predominantly, if not universally, priestly one. So we have to look at that. And then, of course, that leads to the question, at what point in the history of Elmina was the priestly recognized as a secular ruler or given powers? Here in Accra, but there is a clear distinction. And the general oral tradition is that you have the Wolomai who are senior brothers or senior to the chiefs who are junior brothers. And of course, the chiefs of Accra indicate their spiritual links with their white beads around their wrists. So that's one line that we have to investigate. The other thing that struck me was the question of the feedback, because I run into the feedback all the time. And I think it is a subject that we have to subject to serious academic analysis. What kind of feedback is taking place? In Ashanti, when you start talking of Ashanti history, before long, even the slave in Ashanti's court is quoting you rhetoric. At times, they think they are giving you something, or when you tell them, oh, this is rhetoric, I say, but rhetoric got it from us. Which shows the secularity of the interaction. You know, Rattray went about collecting oral traditions and he set them down as authentic representation of the collective memory of the people. And the people have come to accept him and what he did as a true representation of their collective memory and now use it as a veritable source of everything when they are engaged in educations and so forth and so on. So that is one kind of feedback. Another kind is the kind that you find when you start studying the history of chieftaincy conflicts, especially along the coast. The investigations done by Fairley, Crowley, and so forth and so on. Many, many. The archival records are full of these investigations. There are some far less well-known individuals who did excellent work. I've just begun investigating some land and chieftaincy problems in CND. And there are some brilliant, you know, historical documents which are the result of investigations into litigations. And the British were very good at this. They eventually considered part of the issue of ruling a colonial people like us. They eventually considered this a part of this as being able to understand the people and therefore being bound to study and investigate the culture of the people, especially the chieftaincy rule. So there are many documents on this thing. And the feedback that I'm talking about is that now when we are engaged in litigations, we go back to these sources to find out who said what and so forth and so forth. But last point. In doing this kind of thing, I think we have to adopt an interdisciplinary approach. And one area that I often regret we don't consider is archaeological sources. Because Ghanaian archaeology is not too far advanced that there are some very, very important investigations that have been done, especially in Elmina. Of course, it wouldn't have, those sources wouldn't throw much light on Kennedy succession. However, they may have something to tell us. So we need to look at that. So, but thank you very much. We're very interested.
So I want to read. Thank you for this interesting and reflective historical presentation. I have a comment in response to your question of what we historians who use oral history as well as written records should do. I think we explain to our readers, to the best of our knowledge, the position and views of each of our knowledge and view of each of our informants, be they writers or speakers. I also try to acknowledge my own position and limitations. We are telling stories with multiple voices, which sometimes conflict, and acknowledging that it's part of the story. So that was her comment.
Thank you. So. Okay, Herman, maybe we'll take that as the last question.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Yarak. Mine is a quick one. And I think the theory of invention of traditions and feedback is very important, especially along the coast. About 4 years ago, I was having a conversation with my dad, and then he told me that in the Alata quarter of Usu, the chief fisherman is called Zamloja, and he said his ancestor met Don Diogo da Zambuja. And I was stunned. I asked him, wait a minute, but when Don Diogo da Zambuja landed on the Gold Coast, Usu didn't exist, and the Alata quarter of Usu was much later. It's one of the youngest quarters in Usu. So where from this? And to this very day, the people strongly believed that they met Don Diogo da Zambuja, because as Zambuja was a mariner, they were fishermen, they were also mariners, so they have a link. So it's I was excited because I had read Hennig and all that, so I thought it was very interesting, and I had a kind of argument with my dad before he finally gave in to the fact that this is certainly an invented tradition. Thank you very much.
Really appreciate that idea and that distinctive way that the king is presented and represents perhaps a kind of priest kingship. So that's something that I'll certainly think about now and think about more rigorously than I have in the past. I appreciate that comment. I want to just quickly tie in with what Herman said and Professor Adamako and Dr. come back a little bit to Dr. Kambold's question, idea. And that is the, what is this, what should be the relationship, Professor Adamako, walk through it back at me, my own question. And one of the things that some historians have done, which I think very highly of, one of them is Leonard Thompson, now deceased historian of South Africa. He wrote a book called The Political Mythology of Apartheid. And when you have kind of odious ideologies that are rooted in really tendentious reading of the past, he felt that it was then the responsibility of the historian to investigate it and try to put it aside. That was our responsibility. And I think that connects with what Dr. Campbell has said, which is the idea that Columbus discovered America, that American slavery, everybody was happy. Those kinds of ideas, collective memories that certain people have at certain times, do represent a kind of moral threat of some sort. And so it's our responsibility to do it. Are any of these traditions that I've talked about in Elmina of that character? Possibly the way that Ampong Ziadur was used by a faction that really did threaten the order and then ultimately was righted, and it was kind of rejected, but still the result was these guys undertook a really fairly serious crime in order to try to win their case. You know, that's why I said if active historians can find these things and these misreadings of the past, if you will, or readings that don't have that serve particular ideological purposes but don't have any kind of historical rigor to them, then I think it is the role of the historian to try to engage and to be something of an activist. Fortunately, right now, I haven't found anything like that going on in Elmina today, and I just want to tell the story of a fascinating place that's been around for a very long time, that was very important in the past, and whose destruction by the British in 1873 and whose loss of economic stature is a tragedy for those people and their descendants today. And so I want to tell them a little bit about what their place was like before all of these tragedies set themselves down. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think we've had a lot to think about, and I'm sure more investigations will continue. I want to appreciate all of you for your time and for your contributions and for your presence. Thank you very much.
Okay, as always, an engaging and exciting presentation today. Just a few announcements to round up. This evening we have our IES film show, and we'll be showing Half of a Yellow Sun. If you're wondering what is Half of a Yellow Sun and what does it look like, then you will have to come this evening at 5:30 to find that out. Also, next week for our seminar, we'll have a dual presentation with the Humanities Conference. It will serve as part of the Humanities Conference. And we have our visiting scholar, Professor Seth Asuma, and he will be speaking on race, immigration reform, and heteropatriarchal masculinity. If you're wondering what heteropatriarchal masculinity is, you will have to come in order to find out. A subtitle, Reframing the Obama Presidency. All right, so thank you very much for coming. Give yourselves a round of applause.